Thank you very much. Thank you for coming tonight. It's nice to have some audience. Technology, what are the issues? Let's try. There we go. Fred kindly sort of gave a bit of background. I first built walkie-talkies at school in 1964, age 13. Man from Uncle had a thing that looked like a pen. I don't know if any of you are old enough to remember it. I talked into it. I thought it was amazing. I've designed electronic equipment for 40 years. I worked on a thing called mobile fax, which was the Metropolitan Police and some other police forces used to send pictures over their police car radios back in the early 1970s. So it came back a long way before mobile phones. And I've monitored EMF bioFX research on health for about 30 years. I've got a few slides to just bring it in because I was the first speaker. There's a series, you can download them from the internet or you can actually contact the European Environment Agency and they'll send you printed copies free of charge. There's two book volumes, an early one, 2002 or 3, and a new one, 2013 volume 2, looking at late lessons from early warnings, and it looks at a whole lot of things over the last century where official denial and neglect of being precautionary when early things would have been reported have actually ended up in enormous costs, both in health and financially to the societies. Very well worth reading. It's a large range of things in it, and it is free. I've put these in, I think some of the others are going to talk about previous things, just to show you how crazy some things sound nowadays. Radium creams for my healthy clothes. Believe it or not, 100 years ago you could buy cream with radium in for pasty-faced people in cities in the winter to rub into their face to give them a nice healthy glow. Of course, in the end, they discovered it gave them skin cancer. But actually, it was legal to sell and people bought it. X-rays in pregnancy were de rigueur in the medical profession in the 1950s. If you got narrow hips or if you'd had a difficult birth previously, in the third trimester, women were routinely X-rayed. When an amazing doctor, Alice Stewart, who was the first consultant doctor in the country in 1940, amazing woman, thought, I'm seeing more childhood leukemias in the 50s, and no, can't possibly be. Anyway, she started looking at it, talking to mothers, collecting notes, and when she actually got really strong information that showed that if you X-rayed in the third trimester, your child had a two to three-fold extra chance of developing leukemia, and got it published in America in the first instance. The BMJ rejected it, although they did a subsequent one. The British medical establishment came down like a ton of bricks, because it was what they did. 5 years later, no women can really get near an X-ray machine if you're pregnant. But it was something, I mean, I remember in the 1950s, I was born in 51, when I was 6 or 7, you'd go to a Clark shoe shop, and for fitting, you'd put your feet in this machine, and it was real-time X-rays, and you could wiggle your toes to see how much movement your toes had got inside your shoes. And that wasn't with modern imaging technology, that was with gross X-rays coming up on a fluorescent screen, so the dose was really very high. Probably 1,000 times what a chest X-ray would be today. Smoking, you all know about, I won't talk about. Radioactive fallout from bomb tests is still often denied, but actually is almost certainly the cause of a lot of the big increase in cancers that we have today. This is an interesting one, and I've got this one in on purpose. It's the last one, because it was an industry issue. Tetraethyl lead was put into petrol as an anti-knock agent. It means your car engine runs more smoothly. And it was known for a long time that the lead is a brain poison. It lowers your IQ, particularly of children. And eventually, after a lot of arguing, it was agreed to remove it. And you can remove it by actually just better refining the petrol, but that's more expensive. They've now added something called PDBE, which is actually may also have side effects. But anyway, the industry persuaded the EC and all the country governments to let them put benzene in. Now, benzene at the time was a toxic byproduct from the refining process that they were having to pay lots of money to get disposed of. They were having to have it processed to make it safe. Benzene is a class 1 known human carcinogen. So for 10 years, they took tetraethyl lead out of petrol and were allowed to put a known carcinogen in all petrol. Now we've finally, in about 2006, got to generally low benzene petrol. But that's the sort of thing that goes on when there's a vested interest. Electrical smog in the environment. This is 2005. The Swiss government funded the Swiss Agency for Environment, Forest and Landscape, quite the unusual name for what it did, produced a really excellent book about electrical smog. It's again downloadable on the internet, and it's, if you write to or phone them up, they will send you a copy free of charge from Switzerland. It's about 40 pages, A4 pages. It's a really excellent introduction. Life on Earth has grown up in a magnetic environment. The first findings of things, flavoured proteins called cryptochromes, they're part of RNA, 2.5 billion years ago. And then life sort of developed through various stages. Growing up in an electromagnetic environment, both from the fields in the Earth, which produces a field of 50 microtensor, but it's got ripples on it due to the currents flowing in the core of the Earth, but also from the Sun and from Schumann resonances. The Earth ionosphere cavity resonates with lightning, and we all have grown up with a very low frequency, 7.83 hertz roughly, that's permeated life, and it seems to be a sort of zeitgeist, but the Russians put it in all their spacecraft for the space station for long-term health of astronauts. So that's what we grew up in. Now, electrification sort of started in the late 1880s, very early, a bit later really. My village in Cambridgeshire, which is 12, 13 miles from Cambridge and 5-6 miles from Ely, did not get electricity to the whole village. It's quite a big village. Until 1939, just before the war. The reason it got it was that an RAF base being built on the outskirts of the village. So that's actually incredibly modern. You know, that's 70 years, 75 years ago, it got electricity. And then this radio frequency was really only in the last 50 years, and in fact, most of it in the last 20 years, it's had an enormous change. The electromagnetic spectrum goes from static fields from magnets in the Earth down here through electricity, radio, ordinary medium wave radio, microwaves, infrared, visible light, which is tucked in the middle there, ultraviolet, X-rays and gamma rays, and it's split into non-ionizing and ionizing, which is a very false split as it turns out as far as living processes go, but it's a chemical split. If it's ionizing, it can split a covalent bond. If a particle or ray hits a molecule, it can break a covalent bond. But actually, most life processes don't need anything like that energy to disrupt them. This is changes in, it's a graph I did with a colleague, Graham Amber, for a conference a few years ago, looking at the changes in the environment over time. It's a very complicated graph, sorry about that. We've got frequency along the bottom, so that's 1 MHz, that's medium wave radio. This is 1 GHz, which is sort of in the middle of our mobile phone technology, 1-2 GHz. And then that's 1,000 times bigger, and that's another 1,000 times bigger, and there's light, that's where light sits. So it's sort of comparable with the spectrum I showed just now. This scale, the vertical scale, is a very gross scale. It's 1,000-fold between every point. So that's 1,000, 1, 0.001, and 1,000,000. So it's an enormous scale. Now, the natural background level is somewhere around this green area down here. 1950s, as far as we can estimate, we did a lot of research trying to get the figures, is somewhere in this light pink area. 1980s is in this area. And 2010, we've got this whacking great bump here with two little erect protuberances on it. That's the 900 megahertz mobile phone band and some TV frequencies, and that's 1800 megahertz, the high band, and 3G at 2100, and Wi-Fi, the normal Wi-Fi band at 2.45 gigahertz. So these are coming up, these blue lines are actually the international guidance lines, that's the occupational guidance, and that's the general public line. So we're now getting background environmental levels enormously high. In fact, the scale is unbelievable. Those levels are 1 million times higher than they were 100 years ago. That's 10 to the power 18. It is a phenomenal change in our environment. Not necessarily going to have a health effect, but it's something that obviously it could well do. Electric and magnetic fields. Electric fields come from a surface, a charged surface. You know, if you rub a balloon, that gets an electric charge on it, you can stick it on the wall. Well, we're not really concerned about static charge, we're concerned about time-varying charge. This is actually, it's got a good diagram, I quite like this one, but it's actually a touchscreen display like in an iPad, and it's got a layer under here with an AC field on it, and then that scattered across the surface are little receiver pads. And then as you move your hand around it, it detects where the hand is, so you can swipe it. You don't actually even have to touch the screen. Move your hand across the screen, and a series of these little sensor pads works out by the way the electric fields change what you're wanting to do. Magnetic fields come from current passing in a wire. I haven't got time to go into great depth of those. They pass through most things apart from steel or magnetic materials. And electromagnetic radiation, going off, and that's what we're used for on mobile phones, actually is a combination of electric and magnetic fields travelling through space, and they're sort of at right angles to each other. If you stop either of them, you stop the radiation. You don't have to stop both of them, but that's only in the far field. Now, the reason that's important, I won't go into great detail there, but it's very important. This is a router, this is a wireless router access point. At or mobile phone or whatever, this has to be a wireless router. And I've put the two Wi-Fi frequencies in. This, out here is that wave that we saw just now, the radiating wave that goes out into space. And that starts at about a metre, 0.8 of a metre at the normal Wi-Fi band, 0.4 of a metre at the high bands. Within that, this region, it's much more. Are you turning that down? Oh, I can talk closer. Oh, don't turn it up. I can talk closer. This region is very highly bioactive. It's much more bioactive than this region. And almost all the research work that's been done around the world into the safety of phones and Wi-Fi has been done in fields that simulate this region and not in fields that simulate this region. Because it's very difficult to be quite certain what's going on in this region. They've only used this region. But the problem is, the fields in this region, which are non-radiative, are actually much more bioactive. So a lot of the research that's been done has been nearly useless. This is how they assess RF from a mobile device, from a mobile phone or a laptop or an iPad. They basically, this is for a phone, but they use the same principle for everything. They basically have a plastic head, polypropylene normally head, filled with what I've called a gooey, mushy gunk that's nicknamed liquid grey. It is lit like that. It's like a sort of custard, sticky mixture between custard and jelly. And its overall properties are similar to brain tissue. But that's all it is. It is just a mushy, gooey thing. And what they look for is the maximum fields related to heating effects. Well, we're not concerned about heating effects, really, because actually they're already covered in the existing guidance, the things Fred was talking about with high-power microwaves. We're fairly sure the sort of levels that heating effects occur at, and they're protected against. They also mathematically model it in some detail, but only looking at the maximum power. And it's not a great deal to do with proper living, working brains. And if I can use the power to get... Oh, there it is. There's a minute here off Radio 4, which I want to play.
Take these standard spike recordings and to stretch them out from, I mean, you just heard about half a second, say 20 seconds, and at that level you can actually hear what is going on inside each spike. Each spike is more or less the frequency of the human voice. And so for the very first time, you can actually hear the utterances that one nerve cell is making to another. And this rather haunting sound is almost like, I think, seabirds on a cliff talking to each other.
Let's hear it. So what's going on?
Well, we always tend to teach these days that thought and data processing in the brain goes on at the synapses, the junctions between brain cells. I don't believe that. I believe that thought is going on within the nerve cells. The nerve cell is the most highly evolved cell that we know, and it cannot just be switching on or off like a cathode system.
So what the...
Seems to have come to a slightly early stop, so that's fine. That was brain cells chattering to each other. It's actually faster than that. It's actually about 40, 50, 60 hertz cycles. It's a buzzing sound. But of course, that's what's going on in our heads. So if you then interfere with that, if you put other electrical signals in that are sort of similar frequencies, they're going to get interference. It's like getting the dots used to get on television screens when before digital television. The waves that, when that spectrum, traditionally is shown as a sine wave, and a radio wave is like a carrier signal, it's a continuous waveform vibrating at a certain number of times a second, a million times a second, or 100 million times a second. And originally we amplitude modulated them with voice or music. That's the AM radio, medium wave radio, long wave radio. That's relatively benign as far as we know. And then we went to VHF FM radio. That was even more benign because effectively it's just as long as it's low power. It's a continuous power level, but it varies in frequency, so they're squished up a bit and then open back a bit. And it's not very bioactive. But now we've gone on to digital signals, and this is a GSM mobile phone base station, but Wi-Fi is very similar, the timing's different. And you'll see all these very jagged edges, and that's a very interfering signal. In fact, some of the things that happened when GSM phones first came out, National Express coaches had to take a lot of their coaches out, because if in certain seat positions there was a phone went off, the automatic gearbox would actually change unintentionally because of the interference of this sort of pulsing signal. Now, background, this is going back 100 years. The background level is quite loud, I think. But it's basically just a hiss. Then we go to cordless phones. This is a cordless phone. That is on a standard cordless phone, that's 24/7. Even when you're not using the handset, the base unit is putting out pulsing like that from your decked cordless phone base unit. Not from the handset, but from the base unit. And I'll play one more of these. I'm sorry it's loud, but the intention is loud. I want you to think, gosh, this is nasty. That's a 3G signal. Wi-Fi is very similar. I haven't put Wi-Fi on for a reason. Wi-Fi does sound a bit like a mixture of the last two things, but it varies. There's a lot of types of Wi-Fi, which I'll show you in a minute. These are the current guidance levels around the world. Again, the top scale is 1,000, 10,000, 1,000, 100, so it's tenfold. Each of these is tenfold lower, power-wise. That's the main international guidance level. We're allowed up to there for the public. Russia, China, Italy, Switzerland are allowed up to there. That's 100 times lower. Bioinitiative, which is a group of experts that came up and looked at all the literature twice now, recommend this level. These are typical levels that we're surrounded by. So these are mobile phones up here. There's a cordless phone. You'd be surprised how high power a cordless phone is, in fact. That's a Wi-Fi laptop measured by the Health Protection Agency in a study they did in 2011, and I don't have any reason to disagree with it. And these are the health effects down here. So the red bits are where health effects have been found, and we assume that they go on to higher levels. They may not, but the red colouring is the actual levels that they've been found in the science. And we've got things like affecting the blood-brain barrier, DNA damage to sperm, doubling the rate of miscarriage, motor function and memory affected, things that we don't want to see in any of us at the moment, especially in children. I'm not going to do that one, it's too complicated for now. This is also too complicated, I don't want you to read it, I want you to just realise this is Wi-Fi and all the different standards that we've now got. It's phenomenal. That's why I didn't want to play you Wi-Fi, because actually there's Wi-Fi and Wi-Fi and Wi-Fi, and it's changing all the time. But all of them have got nasty high-frequency pulsing. This is a patent, or an extract from a patent by Swisscom. You don't need to read it all. I'll read out this last paragraph here. The purpose is reduction of electrosmog in wireless local networks, i.e. Wi-Fi. And he says, this is Swisscom, big electronics firm in Switzerland, 2004 patent. The influence of electrosmog on the human body is a known problem. The risk to damage to health of damage to health through electrosmog has also become better understood as a result of more recent and improved studies. These findings indicate that the genotoxic effect of electromagnetic radiation is elicited via a non-thermal pathway, i.e. that SAR level thing that I was showing you earlier is now not relevant. And IARC, the World Health Organization's International Agency for Research on Cancer, judged radiofrequency radiation to be a possible human carcinogen in 2011, after a lot of study in the literature. This is the sort of levels you get from a laptop computer. That's 4 volts per litre, and that's a couple of hundred microwatts per square metre. I'll come back to those levels in a subsequent slide, but that's the sort of level from a laptop, and iPads are higher. This is being covered by other people later, but I particularly want to show this because of the other background. We're looking here at 4 volts per metre at that distance. It was in front of the keyboard, so 4 volts per metre. So remember the figure 4. Here is a Bamberg report by some German doctors, 2005, 350 patients, and they listed what the patients came from over a month, I think it was. And then they went and measured the fields in their homes. And group one is no symptoms, and that was things like they'd hurt themselves, cut themselves, burnt themselves, or wanted contraceptives or something like that. And those people actually had very low levels in their homes on average. Group two, which is sleep disturbance, tiredness, depression, headaches, restlessness, irritability, disturbance of concentration, forgetfulness and learning difficulties, is groups 2 and 3. This is the curve for groups 2 and 3. So 60% of those, over 60% of those, were at exposures of over half a volt per metre. Now, the fields from that laptop were 4 volts per metre, they're off the scale here. So is it something we want to sit our children next to? No, in my opinion, it definitely isn't. This is some graphs I did for a Wi-Fi program, the Panorama program, Wi-Fi and Morning Signal, a few years ago. There was a lot of criticism at the time. Industry jumped up and down and hated it. Government hated it, actually. Which is what made them fund the HPA to go and measure laptops in classrooms. And I was a member of Sir William Stewart's Health Protection Agency discussion group at the time. And just under half the group of 20 people signed a thing saying you've got to record health issues here. And the government said, no, we're not funding health issues, we're only going to fund them to measure the signals, specifically excluding the Health Protection Agency to measure any reported health effects. But they did measure the signals, and interestingly, having criticised my measurements, their measurements actually show that I under-measured it, and in fact the levels they got were actually higher. Not a lot higher, but overall their measurements were like 20-25% higher than mine. That's the signal levels you get from a typical mobile mast at 100 metres. And that's the level half a metre away from a Wi-Fi enabled laptop in a classroom. So it is a very considerable exposure. This is some work done. That's a Wi-Fi point in an aircraft. It was a research experiment for the European Commission. Senior committee, and this is the distance away. They did theoretical and actual, and they actually matched surprisingly well. Distance away from this transmitter in the corner here, only at 100 milliwatts, and which is a typical Wi-Fi, normal Wi-Fi access point. And everybody within a few meters was actually significantly exposed. Now the level that sensitive people are regularly reporting effects are right down here at the bottom of those effects. Headaches and concentration and memory and things, which you'll hear about later. So, you know, that's what everybody in there was being exposed to. Again, it just confirms the sort of levels. Getting to the end, that I put this in, although I'm not doing health effects. This was a study of only 94 people in a Spanish town plotted against levels of pulsing microwaves. And what they found was depression increased by up to 64-fold with a very low p-value, very, very highly significant. Fatigue, irritability, headaches increased by 37-fold. And these were the measured fields. And the authors concluded, based on this, the advice is to strive for levels not higher than 1 microwatt per square metre, 0.02 volts per metre for indoor exposure to pulsing microwaves in homes. Signals levels in a Wi-Fi classroom and around the laptops, and especially iPads and tablets, almost always exceed this level by at least 100-fold. So that's what we're potentially doing to our children. There's some of the meters I've designed. Thank you for listening. I'm very happy to talk to you later.